So we're not really sure what people are looking for, obviously.
Today, I am Kathy Salisbury, the director of the Ambler Arboretum of Temple University, and we're going to talk a bit about gardening and landscaping with deer. I just want to acknowledge my background here. It gives me a weird haircut, but it is also, I was allowed to go visit the gardens this morning. So this is a picture from the Ambler Arboretum this morning. So it's looking very nice. So let me share my screen here and we'll get started. Okay, so do this. So hopefully everybody can see that. And so we're going to talk about gardening with deer. And first, just a little bit about the Ambler Arboretum at Temple University. And we're really happy to be partnering up with Upper Dublin Township. All of our programs at the Arboretum have been canceled. And so normally there are walks and talks and workshops that are at the gardens, and we are closed. So we haven't been able to see our visitors, to have programs going on. And so it's great to have this opportunity to partner up with Upper Dublin so that we can continue to educate and engage our neighbors in topics that relate to gardening and horticulture and the environment. And so I'm really thrilled that we're able to partner in this way. So Ambler Arboretum is one of 36 gardens within 30 miles of Philadelphia, and we are part of America's Garden Capital. So you can just go to America's Garden Capital, if you search that, .org, you'll find a website that is just full of information about the gardens around. And when we open back up, you can, if you don't already have one, you can get a passport to all of these gardens and go and visit them. It gives you all the details about hours, what there is to see, all of that kind of stuff in there. So I encourage you to get out there. They range in size from 2 acres to 1,300 acres, and there's something for everybody. There's art museums, sculpture parks, Japanese tea houses. There is history and good food. So even if you know people who don't think there's so much into gardens and gardening, there's something for everyone. So I encourage you to get out and visit. And of course, if you haven't been to the Ambler Arboretum, we're beautiful in all seasons. We want you to come out and visit us too. This is a winter picture of our healing garden, the labyrinth that we have there. And of course, our formal gardens, which date back to the mid-1920s and is a seasonally changing perennial garden with the pavilions at the end. And we have history here. We started out as the Pennsylvania School of Horticulture for Women. This is the old cold frame and greenhouse head house here. It started back in 1911, and you can see some of our trial gardens on display here in the summer. And then we have our fall. This is our conifer garden. And so our gardens are beautiful in all times of the year, and especially in times of the year when you might not think of gardening or going to visit a botanical garden. And that's because we are a place of hands-on horticulture education. And if you think about the way semesters are set up at universities and colleges, the summer isn't the time when the students are there. And spring semester starts in January, and it's not until almost the end of the spring semester where leaves and flowers start blooming. So we have really focused on plants with seasonal interest in the winter and the late fall. So you can actually find flowers in bloom at the Arboretum year round. So we encourage you to come and visit. So with that being said, and my commercial out of the way, we are going to get to our gardening with deer program. So I just wanted to tell you a little bit about who I am and my experience with this. Normally I'd have you do a show of hands to say who has had experiences with deer and have challenges with deer. And in the comment box, I encourage you to answer questions or write your experiences down. I would love to know, and we'll get to this at the end. Hopefully we'll have some time to talk about it. You know, if you've tried techniques to work with deer, have found something that's worked or found something that didn't work, we all like to know, I'm sure. So feel free to put that into the comments box. All right. So my experience with gardening with deer. So I am currently the director of the Arboretum. And of course, we have a significant deer problem there. As some of you may know, Upper Dublin Township does have a deer culling program. So they do deer, they monitor the deer populations, and then they manage them in various ways. And but the Temple University does not participate in that. And so we are an island of safety in the township where there are a lot of deer in the Arboretum. And of course, we're a buffet of all kinds of exotic and native plants that we put on display. And so the deer take advantage of that, and probably even more so now that there's not a lot of people on campus. And so we do struggle with that, and we've tried various things, and I'm happy to talk about them. In addition, I was the president of the Native Plant Society of New Jersey for 9 years. And in that role, we couldn't have talks or discussions or conferences or meetings without talking about the problem about deer as it relates to our ecosystems, our habitats, our plant communities. And so we did a lot, we had a lot of programs about that. And then I used to be the horticulturist for Essex County Park System. So that is the entire county park system in northern New Jersey. And that is, it's the oldest county park system in the country. It's a Frederick Law Olmsted designed, his firm designed the county park system. And so one of the things that it includes two very large reservations in addition to all the parks. And so one of the projects that I was involved in while I was the horticulturist there was I was responsible for the oversight of our deer management program in the form of exclosures. And so what we did is we did have a culling program that went on in the county, which is a euphemism for hunting, right? A deer hunting program where the deer were culled, harvested, measured for scientific data, and then donated to food banks. And as part of the program to manage the deer population to help get a balance between the number of deer and then the plants, because you could look through the reservations that we have and you could just see as far as you could see, because from 4.5 feet down, there was an obvious deer browse line. And the deer browse line, you know, it's just they've eaten everything, every leaf, every twig, every herbaceous plant, every ground cover. And so you can just see through the woods. And that's not a healthy system, right? A healthy system has four layers. It has the ground cover, it has the shrubs, it has the understory trees, and it has the canopy trees. And when you have a deer population that's out of balance, you're missing a couple of those layers. And when you miss those layers, you are missing providing habitat for other wildlife species. So wildlife declines because of this imbalance. And so as part of that, we planted deer, we built deer exclosures that we then filled with native plants that we hoped would be sort of a Noah's Ark, where eventually as we brought the deer population down, didn't eliminate deer, but it brought the deer population down, and the plants inside the exclosures could grow up and set seed, eventually they would escape the exclosures and the deer population would be down enough that seedlings could start to regenerate that forest and we could get those layers back. So that was the goal. So I was in charge of the plant selection, monitoring, and the data collection for those that deer exclosure program, as well as going to all the municipalities to explain why we were doing this and the science behind it. So that's sort of my experience gardening with deer. On a more local personal level, I live in northern Montgomery County and have deer that just roam through my property. And so I'm constantly making decisions and adjusting based on the deer population in my yard too. So very familiar with the circumstances. So So normally if I'm in with a group of people and I could read and see your faces, I would ask you to think of a story, and you can still do this. I want you to think of a deer story, a deer interaction that you've had, and just in your head, or if you're watching with somebody, just sort of think of a story, because you know, deer are everywhere and most of us have a story. And so I wonder about this story you have in mind. And So if you have a story in mind, the next thing I'd like you to do is to, I wonder if any of you had a positive deer story. And generally, they're not positive. Our interactions are usually negative. They've eaten our plants, we got in a car accident, we hit them. So generally the deer stories are negative. So I wonder if you have a positive deer story, if there's anything you can think of that is positive, maybe seeing a fawn, maybe, I don't know what it is, but maybe you have a positive story. And so the next thing I want you to think about was there anything that you could have done to prevent the negative story from happening? Is it you, something that you could have done that would have made a difference in your negative deer story? Or what have you done to prevent the problem from happening again? So you want to think about that too, right? So, I think of a story where I actually traveled to North Central PA where the elk are there, and they're just giant deer. But for some reason I drove hundreds of miles to go see them and hang out and take lots of pictures of them. But when the deer roam through my yard, I actually have a collection of rocks that are the perfect size to throw at them. So it is interesting, right? How we think of different types of wildlife when they're closer and more personal to us. So just something to think about. So you can see this dates back to 1901, this saying. John Muir wrote in our national parks, standing, lying down, walking, running even for its life, the deer is always invincibly graceful and adds beauty and animation to every landscape, a charming animal and a great credit to nature. And I think of this quote because when I was working for the county park system, I found receipts from when they purchased deer to release them back in the woods, because at one point deer were hunted almost to extinction in this area. And so parks and natural species were actually importing deer to revitalize the herd. And so it's all relative, right? And now they're just out of balance in our ecosystem. So deer are a part of this ecosystem, right? They belong here. When they're in balance, they help maintain our eastern deciduous forest community that we're a part of. They actually influence the plant communities. They keep aggressive natives in check. They also keep invasive plants in check, believe it or not. What we found in some deer exclosures is that when we excluded the deer, the invasives became even more of a problem than they were in other places. So deer are actually eating some invasive plants, not all of them, but they're eating some of them and help keeping them in check. But they're also some of they also help maintain balance in our native plants so that we don't have a monoculture all of a sudden of something. They're part of our food chain, they're herbivores, they feed on leaves and plants. Help with the balance of the ecosystem, right? So it's not to say that I'm not aware of, or that we all shouldn't be aware of, the damage that the increased deer population is causing in our ecosystems. But I think it's really important that we understand that they belong here. We built houses in their ecosystems, and they have a role in our environment for healthy forests and natural spaces. A healthy deer population provides prey for predators if there were predators around. And so that is one of the challenges, right? Is we don't have predators. Right now, predators are hunters and cars. And then also we have a disease in our deer herd, chronic wasting disease, which is also thinning the herd slightly. And so, but that's not a way that deer should be controlled, by suffering. And so we had to think about that. So this is a great resource if you're interested in reading up on deer, how we are part of the challenge of the deer population, how we can strive for ecological balance, sort of what goes on. This is a really well-written, easy-to-read book. So if this is something that you're really interested in, I recommend you reading this. So no native vertebrate species in the eastern United States has a more direct effect on habitat integrity than the white-tailed deer. So you can see that in this research, they were looking at the fact that deer may be a bigger threat to eastern forests than the climate changing. And so that is something that we need to consider. There's no hard numbers, but in many states, deer populations continue to rise well beyond historical norms. And in many areas of the country, deer have changed the composition and structure of the forests by preferentially feeding on select plant species. So they're actually changing it. And they are important, but when they're out of control, then they're changing it faster than other animals, other wildlife, and the ecology can adapt. So we know that deer are a problem, right? We see them. This is no surprise to anybody, but this is just some context. And so you see that first quote was in 1901 and how beautiful the deer are and everything. And then 48 years later, Aldo Leopold writes, "I now suspect that just as a deer herd lives in mortal fear of its wolves, so does a mountain live in mortal fear of its deer." So even in the 1940s, there was an indication that there was a problem and an imbalance where the ecosystems were threatened by the deer populations. So this is what I'm saying, I guess, too, is that it's not new. This problem is not new. This challenge is not new. So, of course, we should be well aware of the damage that increased deer populations are causing in our ecosystems. They've actually been linked to the decline of woodland songbirds like this eastern wood peewee. Increased deer populations have caused a decline in 37 of 73 forest songbird species. And a lot of people don't think deer and songbird decline, but that in fact is true and has been happening and has been documented. 2009 research by the University of Pittsburgh and Washington State University in St. Louis linked increased deer populations to an increase in invasive plants in woodlands and exotic plant invasions into woodlands. These occurrences were linked to non-preferential browsing of non-native plants. And so you can see here. So this is an understory in Ralph Stover State Park of burning bush. And so deer, a lot of people plant burning bush. And one of the reasons, not only for its red fall color, but because the deer don't eat it and insects in general don't eat it, which means it's not part of the ecosystem. And so when we do that, then we have the chance of changing the ecosystem or contributing to the change of the ecosystem. A 2003 study by the University of Pittsburgh demonstrated that high population growth rate of garlic mustard is caused by the high abundance of deer. You all might be seeing that blooming now around the landscape, but there's a link between garlic mustard and a deer population. All right. So here, white-tailed deer likely impact every landscape east of the Mississippi. And somehow, sometimes it's considered natural because deer are natural, but the fact is that that we're out of balance. So it's obvious that the deer are affecting above ground species, but it's like an iceberg. There's major effects below the soil surface too. We're seeing a divergence of seeds contained within the soil from what should be there, and seeing the seeds of woody plants are missing from the landscape now. And instead we're seeing an escalation of non-native seeds in the soil. And that has been to the virtual elimination of woody plant seeds. And that is one of the ways that deer are changing the forest by overgrazing. And we can't forget that we have a role to play in all of this, that it's not the deer causing the problems. They're just doing what they're designed to do. It's partially the way we have altered the landscapes and we have developed landscapes in the way we garden that have helped to create the problem, which is uncomfortable to think about, I know. And so that's why this talk is called Landscaping with Deer and not Landscaping Without Deer, because the fact is they're here and we're in their environment. So we're going to talk about their biology a little bit. We're talking about ways that we can landscape with deer in mind that will help us to be more in balance, to understand what they're looking for, and also to understand better how they operate so that we can garden in a way that maybe saves us time and money by not doing exactly what the deer want us to do. So We are going. So what I've also included here is a few video clips from this PBS documentary called The Private Life of Deer. And it gets into the biology of deer, which I think is really helpful when we're thinking about how do we garden and landscape with deer. So here's the first clip with that.
White-tailed deer may seem elusive, secretive, but there's a reason. They live on the boundaries, the borderlands, making a home for themselves in the places between worlds, the spaces between the wilderness and the man-made. It's the habitat known as the edge, where farms meet the forest, and backyards meet the backwoods. Ironically, the human clearing that might harm other species or deprive them of living space works the exact opposite way for the adaptable deer. It allows them to succeed, even thrive. Some say they may be doing too well. Just a century ago, there were less than a million deer in North America. Today, there are nearly 30 million. No wonder it seems they're moving in right down the block. Nowhere are the deer more at home than next door. In the suburbs.
We as humans have created pretty much the perfect habitat for deer. These are areas that have a wide diversity of plants that deer can eat versus, say, a rural forest.
One town that knows all too well about the deer, Cayuga Heights, New York.
We know that in Cayuga Heights, in general, we have about 100 deer per square mile. What we need is far less than 100 per square mile, probably more like 5 per square mile.
With no predators and unlimited food, this is the perfect home for animals that spend most of their lives in an area of just 1 square mile. That's why residents see the same deer family year after year.
They walk through my yard and eat everything here.
It's almost like watching them come into a buffet.
They'll pull up into the driveway and I see 8 to 10 deer. And they kind of look at me like, hey, welcome home.
So 5 deer per square mile. When I worked in central New Jersey, we had 220 deer per square mile. And so so that number is based on the carrying capacity of an ecosystem, which means it's basically about the balance. And it's how many of this animal can this environment support without being damaged. And so that is where they get that number. And of course that varies a little bit, but I've heard from 2 to 10. Depending on the ecosystem and the health of the ecosystem, deer per square mile. And so you all know that we have many more than that here. So some people say, I don't remember seeing this many deer back in the day, right? I don't remember having so many around. But and that's true. Like I mentioned that they were hunted to near extinction in the late 1800s. And so restocking efforts became the norm in the 1900s, as well as regulations on hunting deer that would protect them so that they wouldn't be almost decimated again. And of course, since then, their numbers at the natural predators have been eliminated from the environment in many areas. And so the deer have just been able to repopulate and reproduce exponentially to the detriment of the forest. So of course, profound changes to the landscape and interactions among wildlife species brought about by humans are responsible for the current high densities of white-tailed deer and their effects on the rest of the ecosystem. So that's something important to think about. Of course, we talk about, you know, could we reintroduce the predators for the deer back into the ecosystem? But when you start talking about putting wolves and mountain lions back into our landscapes, people get kind of upset. They get worried about their dogs and their cats that are outside and their small children. And so that is an unpopular option, but the fact is that's who used to keep the deer in check. And so a review of the evidence showed how the decline of cougars and wolves from Yellowstone and other North American national parks led to an increase in browsing animals such as deer and elk, which in turn had what is called a cascading effect, which disrupts vegetation growth and upsets populations of birds and small mammals. And so that is what we see happening here as well, as has been happening for a while. There has been research done, in case you're wondering about the return of the mountain lion. There's an organization called the Cougar Network, and it's fascinating. They track where the cougars are in the country, and cougars have been migrating from a from the Badlands of North Dakota, which is sort of the hub of where mountain lions are, and they've been leapfrogging their way across the country because the young males need to find their own territory, and the cougar territory is very large. So they've been keep moving east and east and east to the point where they found them in Connecticut and New York now. So they are slowly making their way back to the east, so it's not unheard of to find them in this ecosystem. And so here you can see these are actual confirmed sightings of cougars in the United States. And so it gives you an idea of how they're kind of moving around. And so they are a predatory control of deer, but probably, you know, not something you, I don't know, maybe you don't want to see this going through your backyard. But another option, coyotes. People mention coyotes as a way of bringing down the deer population. And we do have coyote in this area. But it's important to note that research has shown that coyote are generally good at maintaining the existing population of deer, so it doesn't get bigger, but they're not very good at bringing the deer population down. And what we really need is the deer population to come down, because there's just too many now. The coyote primarily eat fawn, which means that there's not the next generation, but they don't kill the adults, they don't eat the adults, and so those adults can still reproduce and make new generations of deer. And so coyote, having a healthy coyote population can maintain the existing deer population, but that's still a little too much for us. Sorry, I have my cat here on my lap. So in case you see a tail swishing around, that's who it is. All right, so but another fact is, in our landscapes, we've created home for our deer. The land use changes, development, houses closer together, woodlands disappearing, and a loss of predators have all made it so deer can thrive in this area. And here you can see deer eating from a bird feeder. This is and does happen. People do feed deer intentionally or unintentionally, right? Unintentionally through our gardening practices, and then intentionally, some people feel it's better to feed the deer because they feel bad for the deer. Deer move seasonally from open canopy to a vegetative forest. So that's important to remember. And low density residential areas often provide the open canopy and the forest edge that the deer feel safest in. And so a lot of our suburban neighborhoods are perfect habitat for deer. Also, our fragmentation of habitat. So the fact that we have little forest spaces now that are disconnected also creates lots of edge, and edge is where the deer thrive. And so we've really just made a better situation for deer and a less good situation for the deer's predators, and also made it easier for them to come in our landscapes and eat all of our plants too, or more desirable. If you do know somebody who feeds the deer, I encourage you to share this information with them. I know that there's people out there, especially in the winter, they feel that it's beneficial to feed the deer or feed wildlife. But this pamphlet from the Game Commission explains why that you wouldn't want to feed the deer, that you're not doing them any favors, and actually feeding the deer can harm them. Deer are biologically evolved to eat less and eat different types of food in the winter. So they're evolved to eat twigs and less nutritious plant material to sustain themselves through the winter. And if you start feeding them materials other than what they would naturally find in the woods, they have digestive problems, they can be sick, and it can actually deteriorate their immune system, making them more susceptible to things like chronic wasting disease. Also, a lot of times deer will burn more calories than they need to or than they otherwise would, because they're going out of their way to find these places where deer are being fed. And so that's also putting them at risk. Finally, feeding the deer allows more deer to survive, which is probably the point in why somebody might be feeding them. But if more deer survive, of course, we have more deer. And that is a problem here too. So we want to allow the natural cycle to happen of life and death as much as we can. So here's a perfect place for deer, an early successional area, we call this. So there's fields, the fields are transitioning into forests. So there's low shrub growth, small trees, some herbaceous layer there. And this spot where they can, where the deer can take refuge here in the forest, but come out in here and eat the grasses and flowers, is a perfect place for deer. This is where they like to be. And this is quite often what we've created, right? So here we have this is a deer buffet, right? We see all the hostas here. There's impatiens. The deer eat everything but the ferns in this picture. And you can see it's got a not so dense forest here where the deer can feel safe. They can wander out here, eat to their heart's content, and then go back here if they feel threatened. And so we have created this situation in many of our landscapes. Here's a kind of typical landscape house, residential landscape design. So you can see we've got these trees and shrubs and herbaceous layers that are good for safety, and they can come out and they can go back in and they can hide. And so we've created this edge, which the deer love, in around all of our landscapes. So if you take a look at your property, see if you have edges there. That's where they love to be. And deer will eat anything if they're hungry enough. And so we're going to talk a little bit about where to find plant lists about what deer won't eat. But anecdotes about what deer won't eat in your area are also really helpful, because deer populations are different. So something that is of note, triplets, twins, and singles, as far as fawns go, what they've been finding is that more and more deer, because of the constant access to green lawns and evergreen plants, which if you notice in our forest ecosystem, there's not a ton of evergreen plants out there. And so what's out there is in high demand, and there's a lot of competition for it. By us planting a lot of evergreen plants, there's a lot more nutrition available through the winter for deer, which enables them to raise triplets and twins much more often, so that twins are the norm now rather than just one single fawn. And they often have triplets and are able to raise at least two of those triplets. And so that means that the population is expanding even more exponentially, right? And so we have to think about that. So what we're gardening and what we like to see is enabling the population to just explode. The deer will eat grasses, especially cool season grasses, which are our lawn grasses. And especially when they're preparing to raise their young, and they're just looking for as much nutrients as possible. So we want to keep that in mind. So the deer are an edge species, and now the world is one big edge, right? We've created home. So if you aren't familiar, there's this book called Noah's Garden by Sarah Stein. And what she's done in part, I highly recommend it. It's a very easily read book. It is, she talks about all of her mistakes that she made as she's trying to transition her landscape from a typical suburban landscape to a more natural ecosystem. And one of the things she recommends here is to defragment our green spaces. And so you can see if everybody dedicates corners of their property to forest, that for a layered system of a healthy forest, then you create places where the deer can thrive without coming into your yards, coming into your landscapes, and they can move about without coming in there. So it's just something, a new way of landscaping to think about, where you have to talk to your neighbors about what they're doing and maybe work towards that. So a 2011 research paper confirmed a couple of facts, that suburban deer have a smaller range than their country cousins, right? That they stay more local, that they're drawn to the presence of a lawn, to shrubs, and to edge cover. That's why they like this, and that's why they don't go very far, because they have everything they need. But what they found most was that the fragmentation of space had the greatest correlation to the population of deer. So the more that green spaces were fragmented, the more increase in population of deer in an area there was. So if we can stop this fragmentation, the deer can distribute farther and wider and not be so concentrated in our areas. So if you want to know if your plants will be eaten or what determines whether or not your plants will be eaten, there's some things that they're looking for, nutritional needs. Deer can actually smell and tell the nutritional value of the plant. And so that explains why sometimes they'll eat something and sometimes they'll just walk right past it. At different times of the year, it's more nutritional. And so at certain times of the year, they're going to eat it, and certain times of the year, they're going to avoid it. Previous feeding experiences, whether or not they like it, seasonal factors, and the availability of alternate foods all influence whether or not your plants will be eaten. Deer do get a third of their water from the moisture in plants, so they're not only just looking for calories, but they're looking for water. They eat more than 500 species of plants. So they'll try anything. New deer fawns are experimenting, and so things that had never been eaten in your yard before will get eaten, because the fawns are testing things out to see what they like. They selectively browse when there's a lot of diversity and a lot of plant material available for them to eat, but they will eat more when natural food is not available, when there's sort of a desert of plant material available to them. They'll just come in and eat everything. And they do feed in predictable travel patterns. So you may notice that the deer have a habit. At a certain time of the day, they wander through your yard. And what you can do is kind of disrupt that to kind of get them away from your plants. And we'll talk about how you can do that. Past damage is definitely a good indicator of future damage because of this habitual nature of deer. New plantings added to an already damaged garden will be damaged as well. So that's important to keep in mind too.
What makes the whitetail such a challenge to backyard gardeners is they eat almost anything. Nearly 600 different species of plants, grasses, acorns, fruits. In times of scarcity, they will consume twigs and bark, even poison ivy. Incredibly, they've also been spotted eating nestling songbirds. And very little deters them.
Nesting songbirds. It's something that was such a surprise to me. So if you want to know why they're eating your plants and why they might find your landscape particularly desirable, they may feel safe in your landscape that you've created. They have that edge, that place for safety that they can run to if they feel threatened. The snow might be covering of naturally available food, and you have items available to them that they can't find in the woods. If there's a high concentration of deer, of course, they eat a lot of different types of plants. And then they forage at dusk and dawn. They're called crepuscular, which we'll talk about in a little bit too. And so if there's not a lot of activity in your yard at those times, at dusk and dawn, they feel safe there. They do have an ability to adapt to a man-made ecosystem. There aren't many predators at all for them here. We have mild winters, which means that our green plants are available for a much longer period of time through the year. And so they have food year round. So that's why they're coming in. It can be that if you never noticed deer in your landscape before, but now you do, you want to take a look around your neighborhood and the surrounding areas and see if there's new construction going on or new fences going up, new development happening that could have changed that habitual pathway that deer take and forced them to find a new route that now leads through your yard. So you want to check that. And then laws protecting wildlife, of course, hunting laws and regulations make it so we can't control the deer in by hunting. So food requirements of deer, they eat a lot. So they require 6 to 12 pounds of forage daily. So that is a lot of leaves and twigs and buds and flowers, right? And they're very adaptable, just like raccoons and rabbits and even coyote, right? So they're just perfectly set up for survival in suburbia. They are capable of learning. We might think that they're stupid, but they're not, and they do learn. And they do make adjustments based on this learning.
Deer can learn and adapt to a suburban environment. They can get to know individual dogs and which ones are okay and which ones aren't. Over time, they might become habituated to the dog and become okay or not afraid.
The deer stop and turn and look at him as if to say, okay, we're done with our chase for the day. He only goes just to the edge of our property line, and then the deer seem to know.
Another example might be deer not being afraid because they know the dog is on a leash and it can only go so far.
So here's Trigger, and he needs to go out in the backyard.
A lot of deer out there. He chases them. As you can see, this one didn't even move.
The deer clearly grasp the limits of the danger.
Poor beagle. So how do you know if you have deer in your yard, right? You probably have seen them around here, and you've probably seen evidence of them having eaten your plants. You might find plants nibbled to their base overnight. The plants simply disappear. They might even be pulled up out of the ground. If you planted pansies or something this spring, the deer come in, they try to eat them, and they lift them up out of the ground, and then the whole soil mass is out. You can find tender new growth at the tips of small trees and shrubs nibbled off, so the buds and the flower buds are nibbled off. Here you see an example of arborvitae planted. When I teach woody plant identification to my students, I tell them that around here they could use this as an identification feature, that our American arborvitae, the deer just love it, and then you get this nice shape. That deer browse line, so here's a perfect example of that browse line from about 4.5 feet down. They've just eaten everything and they don't need to expend their energy to reach up higher because they have everything they want right there. So they do eat that. So this is a good deer browse line. You'll see this line all over on these arborvitae hedges. You might see the bark on trunks of small trees torn and abraded by buck rub during certain times of the year. And what's important to note is the deer have a certain mark that they leave when they eat plant material because of the way their jaw is. And so deer basically don't have top teeth, they just have bottom teeth. So when they bite, they have to bite and pull and tug at the plant. So if you see ragged edges at the ends of your plants, where they've been eaten, that's probably a deer, because unlike rodents, so if you're wondering if it's a rabbit or a groundhog, rodents have teeth at the top and the bottom, so they can snip the plants very cleanly and make a clean line, where deer don't have that, and so they tug and they leave an irregular and often kind of ragged end, and that's how you can know whether or not you're dealing with deer or if you have some other critter eating the plants in your yard. Around here, it's possible to have both, but it's good to know what you're dealing with where. Buck rub is another problem in our landscapes. And so the bucks rub their antlers along conifers and hardwoods. Along determined paths, they tend to have a habit of going a certain way to do this. And so they like trees about 6 inches or less in diameter. And so You want to protect your trees and shrubs from September through November. At the Arboretum, we do it September through spring. We just leave these up. And on all of our small trees that we've planted and relatively new over the last few years, and we just protect them in a variety of ways, but usually with corrugated plastic, and to keep the bucks from doing this. Because what happens is, you can see in this picture, the buck rub all of the bark off of the trunk here, and that exposes the growing portions of the trees and often stops water and nutrients from moving up and down and kills the tree, especially because it's a smaller tree. So you want to be able to protect them from that. That's another problem in the landscape. So what can you do, right? So we've talked about all of this stuff you know already, that deer are here and they're causing problems and they're eating all your landscape. So what are your options for gardening with deer in your landscape? So we have fencing, repellents, and plant selection. Those are the top three go-tos for when it comes to deer. So we're going to talk a little bit about each of those. So you want to come up with a strategy. What are you going to do in your landscape? You want to plan this out. And so you want to ask yourself some questions about what exactly is going on in your landscape and what you're willing to do. So you want to, how much damage are you experiencing? Where is it? How is it happening? What particular plants do they seem to like more? And which do they seem not to bother at all? How much damage can you tolerate? And where? Remember, some of our native plants, if you're into gardening with native plants, they've evolved with deer. So deer browse, the plants can bounce back from that to a certain degree. And so it's okay if they're being nibbled, but and they're surviving and they're still flowering and still setting seed. When it becomes a problem is when they're just decimated down to nothing. And that's what you want to look out for. Are you going to protect established plants? Are you going to purchase new ones? If you purchase new ones, you know, you want to look at deer resistance, what they're not eating in your neighborhood. What is your budget? How much is it going to cost to protect or buy new? And unmanaged deer populations can double in 3 to 5 years. So how much are you willing to spend on deer control, knowing that the population is only growing? And then are you concerned with other deer problems, tick-borne diseases, auto strikes, and that kind of thing? These are just questions you want to ask yourself and to determine what you might do in your own landscape. The other question I think it's really important to ask yourself is, how will what you do affect the world, the neighborhood, the people around you? And I use this in particular, this question, when it comes to fencing, because a lot of us, our first inclination is to put fences around our property. And what that does is that pushes the problem into somebody else's property. Maybe it's a person who with less means, who cannot afford a fence, and then their landscape is at risk even more so because the deer now have to find new places to go. But it also pushes the deer problem into public green spaces, and it degrades our public green spaces, which are supposed to be there in perpetuity for the good of the public. And it's pushing that problem into those public areas. And I think that that should be considered as well. And those areas shouldn't be fenced off. They should be accessible to people to explore. And so so I think it's important to take this question into consideration also as you decide what you would like to do about your deer issue. So when we talk about fencing, which we will, we wanna consider the height and style of the fencing, right? So when we look at our deer fencing options, there are a few options. So there's the standard 8-foot deer fence, the double fence, electric and angled, will go to each of these. There's different levels of and duration of protection for these. And you can find lots of information online about each of these and specifications. If you want to build these, you of course have to check with your municipality to see what is allowed. But you really must take into account the size of the animal, how smart it is, and the physical ability of the animal when you're figuring out what fence you want to put in. So here's a pretty standard plastic deer fence, and this is usually used in woodland settings because it disappears. You can't see it in the woods, but the deer are kept out. But it's important to remember that deer can jump and pretty high, and there's different motivating factors for them. And so you want to you want to think of those as well. Additionally, by putting something like this up, that's the same width of hole in the fence, you're keeping all wildlife out, and you might not want to do that. Your fox, rabbits, you know, all of those other great wildlife that we have around, you're keeping those out as well. There are deer fence options which have wider holes at the bottom so that other wildlife can move back and forth around the landscape. So you want to consider that. So we have the standard 8-foot fence. That's what's usually recommended to keep deer out, is an 8-foot fence. Another option is a double fence. So for places where you don't have the ability to put in a very tall fence, you can do a double fence. The deer can't calculate this and it looks like a trap, or they might not be able to get out of it. So they tend not to leap into it. And so here, this is very fancy double fence, but this is an example of an option that you could use. Electric fencing, you can move the path of deer this way. So you can keep them out of a space, but you can also sort of guide them into another direction, maybe into the back edge of your landscape, instead of having them come into the garden. By setting up this electric fencing that's portable, you can just sort of move them around and kind of get them afraid of certain spaces in your yard. And this is, of course, you're baiting it so that they do touch the electric fence and then become afraid of it. And then there is this angled fencing. So again, this is similar to the double fencing, where if you can't put up a fence that's 8 feet high because of regulations in your municipality, you can put an angled fence. And that is the deer can't calculate that. They're not sure if they can get over that without jumping onto it. And so they tend not to jump or not to attempt it. And so that's another idea for you.
In the backyard, on the side,
the fence is 6 feet high, and they have jumped over it, which amazed us.
As you can see, we had to install this fence to keep the deer out of our yard. This is a 6-foot fence, which actually is somewhat inadequate.
White-tailed deer will jump in the wild. They use this technique to evade predators and to just overcome an obstacle that's in their way.
We had to build a really tall fence because deer were continuously jumping over it.
Deer can jump over an 8-foot obstacle. Sometimes from a running start, they can clear a bit more than that.
The other thing you want to think about with fencing is maintenance. If you live in a wooded area, you're constantly picking branches off and worried about the trees falling on your fence. So you want to think about the maintenance needs of that fence that you install as well. One thing just quick about this picture, what I like about this is that it is a small area that's fenced in. It's not the entire yard. So maybe you just fence in a little bit of an area to protect the space, but then you leave the other parts of your garden and your landscape open for roaming so that you're not pushing the problem completely out into somebody else's. For my house, I have my vegetable garden fenced off, but the other almost 2 acres is open. And so then we have repellents. Repellents work in different ways. So there's either taste, odor, pain, or fear repellents. Usually they're applied as a spray, and they're most effective when you apply them on a regular 4-week schedule and you start before any damage is evident. So if you're aware of plants that have been damaged in the past, in the spring, as soon as buds start to emerge, as soon as it gets warm enough that you want to go outside, you start spraying those plants, and that'll deter the deer from coming around right away. And then you want to rotate these. So you want to use a taste one, then an odor one, then a pain one. You don't want to use the same one all the time, because deer learn and they do get used to it. They learn that there's not a threat there. And so you want to use more than one repellent. There are a number of research articles, fact sheets from Extension, that tell you the different repellents that are out there and which ones seem to work best. So I recommend that. This was liquid fence. This is one that's pretty popular and works. Malorganite is anecdotally, it's a fertilizer made out of composted sewage sludge. Anecdotally, I've heard from lots of people that using this keeps deer out of landscapes. It smells terrible, and I would stay out of the landscape where it was. So that is something that I've heard. Here is reusable barrier ribbon that is treated with a repellent. And so here you see it's just a portable ribbon. Again, this could work like an electric fence where you're moving deer around and sort of out of their habitual paths. And so other repellents, dogs, noise-making devices, motion-activated sprinklers, Mylar balloons, predator urine, whatever you choose to use for a repellent, the deer are going to get used to it. So it has to move and it has to change. That is the key. If you're going to let your dogs out, don't let them out at the same time every day, especially let them out at those crepuscular hours, those dawn and dusk, and just let them out into different areas. There are homemade repellents that you can use. There's plenty of recipes out there. A lot of them are effective. And so you can test those out. There's no scientific evidence about these, especially Irish Spring, hanging that from your trees, if that works. There's no evidence of that. In fact, and some studies have shown that the soap actually attracts voles. Using blood meal sometimes is also said to deter deer, but that attracts skunks. So which would you rather have, deer or skunks in your yard? So you want to take into account there's pros and cons of all of these. The smelly sachets, there's no scientific evidence that human or pet hair keeps deer away. So you don't need to put sachets of hair around your yard. You don't need to do that. It just doesn't. But these blender concoctions that have garlic and hot peppers and eggs, those do tend to work.
Nearly blind by human standards, deer have trouble seeing defined shapes. All they can really make out is movement. To compensate, they've developed their other senses. Their hearing is finely tuned, and their remarkable sense of smell can pick out odors hundreds of yards away. The nose of the white-tailed deer has nearly 300 million olfactory receptors, compared to just 5 million for humans. That's more than even the legendary bloodhound.
So the deer are able to smell much better than they're able to see, which is why they just sort of stand there when you think they should be seeing you and running away. And they're just sort of standing there and you're like, why aren't they scared of me? It's probably because they're not seeing you and they're picking up your scent, trying to figure out what's going on. But that the fact that they have so many, they have such good noses, that's why the repellents work so well. They're just repellent tests. So you can find this research out there. Deer away, liquid fence, those all work. Deer scram. The important thing is to change it up.
On the borders of yards and roads, there are other edges deer inhabit. The edges of the day.
Deer have natural rhythms throughout the day. And the period that they're most active is in the early morning or the late afternoon. And that's when they do a lot of their feeding. And this behavior is known as being crepuscular.
Crepuscular. Creatures of the shadows, of the dawn and the dusk. Whitetail are perfectly adapted for those hours. Their camouflage blends in. And it's the time their vision actually works best. Attuned to the gathering darkness.
So they don't see well and they smell very well. And then plant selection. So we talked about fences, we talked about repellent. And so plant selection, that's another way that we can garden with deer. So in general, this is very general, and of course there's exceptions to every rule. Deer tend to avoid plants with strong odors. So if you can scratch the branch of a tree or shrub or the stem of a flower, and it has a very strong odor, that usually means it's really high in oils, and those oils aren't palatable to deer. And so that's why in our woods, things like spice bush tend to be avoided by deer, because they have all these oils in them. Fuzzy or prickly leaves, they tend to avoid. It's not that they won't eat it, but if there's other plants around, they'll avoid these. And so that's something to keep in mind. Milky sap, so things like milkweed, they tend to avoid because of that milky sap, which also has that bitter or alkaloid taste. That also explains why you don't see deer munching on dandelions. They're very bitter and they have that milky sap on them. And so if you take a look at plants in the landscape, you can look for these features and maybe introduce some resilience in your landscape to deer. But it's a fact, when they're hungry in the early spring after winter, they'll eat anything green. And in the summer, they'll get more selective. But in the fall, as they're readying themselves for winter again, they'll start being less selective in what they eat. And so it is seasonal. I really highly recommend that you take a walk around landscapes, take a walk around your neighborhood, take a walk around the woods and see what's not being eaten. And then see if you can include some of those in your landscape, because that is what will tend to not be devoured in your own landscape. There is another theory called bullseye landscaping, where you basically plant the most at-risk plants for deer browse closest to the house, and then use more and more deer resistant or less desirable plants for deer the farther out you go from the house, with the idea that the deer won't come close to the house. But this is a crap theory, honestly. I've seen deer eating pansies right out of window boxes on the house. And so the deer are really not too worried about coming close to your house, it seems. And so really you want to look at what's not being eaten in your neighborhood. So the idea of deer resistant plants, the whether or not a plant gets eaten depends on the population of the deer you have, not on the plant itself. All plants might be eaten if the deer are hungry enough. You can get books that list deer-resistant plants. There's been research on it. Rutgers University has a great website where you can search the plant you're interested in, and it'll tell you the deer resistance, the deer browse resistance for it, whether or not it's highly browsed or somewhat browsed or almost never browsed on that. And so those are good resources for you. There's new ones out. There's always books about deer-resistant plants coming out. But I do want to caution you that in many of these cases, in those books and in that Rutgers website, that the plants that are suggested are measured by deer browse only. They're not measured by whether or not they're invasive or native or any of that. So you don't want to just take that into consideration, because the plants we choose to put in our landscapes can significantly impact the environment around us. Deer are part of the ecosystem. They're part of the food web. They influence plant growth. But deer-resistant plants have escaped into the environment, as I've shown before. So here's burning bush, which is deer-resistant. Deer don't eat it. But look at what it does when it escapes into the environment. Same with barberry. This entire understory is Japanese barberry. This is another state park in New Jersey. And so because the deer don't eat them in the landscape, it means that they don't eat them in the wild either, and that they're not part of a system. And then they outcompete our native plants. And the native plants then become more highly desirable, and there's less of them, which diminishes our native plant populations and increases places where invasive plants can grow. So it's a vicious cycle. Higher feeding on less available native plants equals less native plants, which equals less of the wildlife we like having around, whether it's for fishing or for hunting or for just bird watching. Less native plants equals less wildlife. And this is a butterfly bush, and it's invasive. So here's the Rutgers site. Again, remember, this does not talk about invasiveness of these plants. It just tells you, you can search by the plant, and it tells you whether or not, in their experience, it's eaten by deer. It is a great place to start, though, if you're interested in deer. A lot of nonprofits, botanical gardens, have fact sheets, and you can find lists of deer resistant and deer tolerant plants here. So here's an example from Bowman's Hill Wildflower Preserve, which you can find online. fact sheet from Maryland Cooperative Extension, resistance of ornamentals to deer damage. So you can find that information out there. There are so many options, and it so much depends on your particular site, the sun, the moisture, you know, all of that, there are certain plants you can almost guarantee that the deer won't browse, but it's better to kind of take a look at your landscape and then make decisions based on this. So when we say we have suburban deer, we've created home, we then add our garlic spray repellent to it, right? Then we put stinky malorganite all around to keep the deer away. And then we're hanging soap from the tree branches. And then we put a fence around it, right? So it's like, no wonder why deer won't want to come into our landscape anymore. I don't know if I would want to come into my landscape anymore if it was in this condition. So we really want to think about, you know, a balance and keeping it enjoyable for us as well, right? So of course, there are other options. In Florida, pythons, the invasive pythons, are eating deer. And there are programs where hunters are brought in to manage deer populations and also help feed the hungry in the region where they're hunting the deer. So that is something to consider as well. And so finally,
present as the whitetails are around us, they are never domesticated, never truly tamed. For some of the suburban homeowners, after 3 months tracking the deer, their cameras revealed a truth long forgotten.
Oh, there's one hiss at us.
Even here in the suburbs, these are wild creatures.
Filming the deer gave me a little bit more insight into what they're doing besides just eating the gardens that I created. I got to see them more as wild animals, and I like to be able to see that version of deer.
Right outside the window, just beyond the door, they are a link back, a reminder of the wilderness that surrounds us still.
I've often remarked to my wife that people will travel to Africa to go on a safari, but here we have the deer, who they're just as beautiful and just as interesting to watch. It is a real privilege to have that.
Right, so we can think of our landscapes, right, as a suburban safari. So I hope this helps answer some questions about gardening with deer, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have. I think Tammy is going to kind of moderate that if there are any. The presentation's been recorded, so the graphics that I had on there and the charts about the repellent, you can go back in and see those and pause it and take notes if you like. And I know there was one question about, can you visit the Ambler Arboretum? We're not open yet. There are people using it, but we are technically not open. So I just want you to know that. So I don't know if anybody else has any questions, but thank you so much for joining us today. And I do hope to see you in the garden soon and maybe back at another program.
All right, if you would like to put a message in the chat box, I would be happy to read that. Or if you'd like to raise your hand, I will unmute you and you can ask your question directly to Kathy. All right, well, seeing no question, let's see, going once, going twice.
Well, you can always reach me by email at the Ambler Arboretum, and I'm happy to answer questions. It's something I love to do. So if you don't feel comfortable saying it here or you want to think about it, then just reach out to me when you can, and I will get back to you.
All right. Well, I'd like to thank all of you for participating today and thank Kathy for her presentation. Lots of information. And as she said, it has been recorded. It will be available online on the Upper Dublin Parks and Recreation YouTube channel, as well as on our website within the next couple days. If you have any questions, you can either email Kathy, or if you want to email me, I would be happy to forward those questions on to her as well. But at this time, I'd like to thank everybody. Hope you have a wonderful day. And I hope we see you again very soon. Kathy will be presenting again on Friday at 3 o'clock, and she'll be doing a presentation on composting. If you would be interested in participating in that, you do need to register through our software like you did today. So please feel free. We have lots of other opportunities. And all of those information pieces are on social media as well as on our website. Thank you, Kathy, and thanks everybody for joining us today.